One of the things that I hated most when I was a kid was the expression that the educators use. He has a lot of potential, right? He has a lot of potential. It's a very bad thing, you know. I usually see it many times. If a person's so-called, and we all have a certain potential, if a person fails in school, it's not necessarily a failure of the child, more the failure of the teachers to educate the child appropriately. Of course, there are many things involved in that, environment and so on and so forth. But, you know, overall, but the word he has potential, the expression he has potential is a very dangerous thing. That potential, that thing carries us throughout our lives. All in everything that we do. We have the story of Bnei Gad, Reuven, and Chetzi Shevet HaMenashe, those 2.5 tribes, that coming to Moshe, you know, they said, listen, Moshe, we want to settle down in the eastern side of the Jordan River. And the reaction should be, what are you talking about? What are you talking about? You came out of Mitzrayim. You walked 40 years in the desert. You had some ups and a lot of downs. Finally, you're coming to the promised land. And now you said, I don't want. What kind of a thing is that? And not only that, they use an excuse. And what did they say? Listen, Moshe, we have a lot of cattle, it's green out there, la 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 la. This is a fascinating excuse. Why? Because if you know the terrain, there's not a lot of grass there. It's a desert. If you go to Jordan, the only place that maybe some green is really in the Golan Heights, but the rest of it is all a desert. It's dry. It's an excuse. So do we. Many times we make excuses. You should know the potential is not a purpose. And potential without a purpose is nothing. Many times we do this in our lives. You know, a guy goes out with a date. He finally finds the girl of his dreams exactly to his list. You know, everything, check, 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 check. All right, you got it all. Guess what? He gets cold feet, crash and burn. He's out of there. Like, you know, like the planes, those are F-15s. You know, they go like this, all of a sudden, he bugs out. Makara, they pull stunts more than Maverick, the Tom Cruise and Top Gun. You know, they're out of there. They'll find some kind of an excuse and they'll always dump the responsibility on somebody else. This is terrible. You know, a person, a woman can get a job, you know, she gets a job of her dreams, and all of a sudden she finds an excuse. That is not what I really want. They don't, you know, they pay you. That's what you wanted. You are, I don't know, whatever it is that you do. That's what you wanted. Here's the job. Here's the salary. Here's everything. I don't know if I really want that. I don't know if I really do good at that. All of a sudden, she from a career woman, she wants to be a career woman, to have her own business, to open this, to move her and shake her. All of a sudden, I want to stay home, have babies. Makara, what happens? They go out. That untapped potential leads you nowhere. Basically, it's an escape out. It's a route out. It's an escape which gives you an opportunity not to fail. You put the responsibility of something else. You know? If you're going to force me, I'll do it. But the responsibility of something else. The fear of failure. The fear of the unknown. It's a new job, I don't want to know, new style. People move from countries and different cultures, different languages. I don't know, they seem to be okay. We are here, we have all the tools, we went to college, we got our degrees, we got a BA, the MA, the BS, the whatever you want we got, right? And all of a sudden, you know, we can't do anything with it. You get some kind of a job, it's like a secretary answering for, hello, Yeshiva, you know? You have a, I don't know, a PhD in, you know, Greek philosophy, and all you bother doing is answering phones, or you're like, I don't know, became like a assistant to a, you know, daycare assistant. I mean, that's what it's all about. What happened here? And that's a fear. We have a fear. And we make all the excuses in the books. But those excuses are no more than just plain excuses. That's why we don't become successful. That's why we don't meet the person we meet. We compromise. We are afraid to take a challenge. We don't date, for example, people who would challenge us in terms of their intellect. Many people feel very comfortable with somebody dumber than they are or less observant than they are. So they would not come to be judged their observance. How, you know, many guys, and I can tell you for a fact, not deliberately, but marry girls who would make them go to work. They would not say, you know, he comes with a party line. Yeah, I want to dedicate my life to Torah. You know, it sounds like Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor, right? But there's no more than that. All of a sudden, the girls come, and she says to him, you know, Habibi, we need a little bit of a ring here. Habibi, go to work. We can do that. I want my house. I want the penthouse. I want the two marble lions sitting like this, you know, at the gate, you know, like that. You know what I'm saying? Well, the eagles. So much love for that. Oh, Yofi, Timsol lo dash mimeni. So, you know, all of a sudden, close the door there. All of a sudden, you know, she says to him, Habibi, we gotta go to work. And that's exactly what he wanted. You know, he didn't want somebody who's going to tell him, listen, mister, you know, Torah is kol chayenu, aval lo bishvileinu. Torah is all our life, but not for us, you know? She says to him, go to work. And he says, okay, you know, it's not me, Rabbi. It's really not me. It's my wife. She puts pressure on me. Okay, so put pressure back. Aren't you the husband? Aren't you the one who knows Torah? This is that what you wanted? No, you didn't want to learn Torah. You want to go to work. You wanted somebody to force you. You want somebody to manipulate you like a joystick, like this. Oh, my wife wants me to talk to her. Habibti, Motek Sheli, my darling, I'll talk to you in Olam Haba forever and ever. Right now, I'm working on getting us the Olam Haba. You sit in home, you do whatever you want to do, go get a degree, go become whatever you want, but I am learning. You don't have this attitude. You dump the responsibility on your wife. You dump the responsibility on your parents. You dump the responsibility. It's not my failure, it's their failure. I have potential, but I don't have any purpose. That's why it accumulates to absolutely nothing. I operate through fear. You know, you could be a genius. Oh, you know, but it's a difficult program. They're not going to accept me because of that. I'm not going to apply. What should I waste my time? What should I waste $100? You're wasting $100 left and right. But you became the acceptance committee. Go in. Chazal tells us, "Shlach lach mechal penei amayim, ki berov hayamim timtzeinu." So I do it. Don't be afraid. All this thing, by the way, I learned from my wife. I learned this all from my wife. I'm not embarrassed to say it. I'm very proud to say that. You know, my wife is a person who helps me and challenges me to become a better person all the time. And her approach to life, she's a go-getter. She's not afraid of anything. And I learned a lot from her. I learned a lot from her. I mean, maybe the only reason I'm here is because of her. She's much smarter than I am. And I love that because I become smarter. You know, she has more guts than I do. And I do have a gut, you know. I love that. I want to go forward. I want to become better. I did here all the life in my life. Oh, I got a potential. So, okay, so now, you know, I need somebody to teach me how to do so. So that's what I did. And so the reason why immigrants, for example, do better than you is for this reason. So what is Moshe telling Bnei Gad, or Bnei Menashe, and Reuven, and all the Chevre? He says, okay, you don't want to go? I understand. Listen, you didn't need to come to the promised land. You know that you will have to fight for the promised land. The promise is promised for you. It's promised for you. But you need to go and get it. You need to go and fight it. And you need to go fight for this land every single time. Upon every time you're going to return to the land, you need to fight for it. This is how you make it yours. This is how you call it, put your name on it. I understand you are afraid. But I'll tell you what you're going to do. Moshe is wonderfully wise. I love him. I love Moshe Rabbeinu. He's an amazing person. Amazing. He said that he's better. He's the father not only of all our spiritual, you know, being. He's also the father of all life coaches. He said, I'll tell you how to deal with fear. You attack it. You're afraid of something? You put yourself right in it. Not only at the front, not only fighting for it. You're going to be the point, the tip of the spear, which goes in and launches into that fear. You're going to be the ones who is going to lead the attack. When you're afraid of something, you need to designate what is it that you're afraid of. You need to look it in the eye and go right in. Don't be afraid. The best defense is an offense. And the best offense is to be a better offense. There's no such thing. You go in, nothing to be afraid of. You give a purpose to your potential. You don't let fear immobilize you. Now you do it. What's the worst thing can happen? So you apply to this prestige program, and they said to you, sir, no. They said, okay, I tried. Better to try. And you know that you are worth nothing, and work yourself up from that acknowledgement, than to live all your life in assumptions that I could have, would have, should have, and actually became a nothing, and eat your inside out, and to say, I know, I could, I would, if I did this, you know, I have the ability, blah, 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 blah. So when an immigrant comes to a new land, he's forced to jump into the water. Otherwise, he's just going to fall off the face of the earth. So he comes in, he doesn't speak a word of English, he works his whatever off, he jumps right in, he hustles, he bustles, and that's what the strength of America, because it's or Israel to that matter as well. You come in, you jump in. When you start with entitlement programs, you cripple yourself as a society, and you cripple the people themselves as newcomers integrating into your society. No such programs. This is the land of lost opportunity, because we became the land of entitlement. The same thing in Israel. New immigrants come, give him a house, give him a this, give him a that, give him this, give him that. So what do the people do? They come in, they get the free refrigerator, the dishwasher, the dishwasher, the whatever washer. They sell it, take the money and run. You know how many people came to Israel, did what I just told you, and then came back to America with all the money they made there? Entitlement. You want to come to Israel? Hey, not a problem. Roll your sleeves, get to work. That's what made Israel, Israel. You start with entitlement, you cripple the whole entire program. Give them the tools, in other words, give them the education, proper education, equal education to all, regardless of race, color, skin, religion, whatever it is, give them opportunity, give them the tools to be proud. When you achieve something, you become proud of it. When you're proud of something, you want to continue to be a part of it. But when you don't, look what happened to England. England is almost like a socialist country. So all the immigrants that came to England or to Europe hate the place, regardless of how much freebies they got. I think if you go to Norway, Norway allows you to go free to the school. Any college you want to go in here, Norway, you can go free from anywhere in the world. And yet the people who hate Norway, most of them immigrants from Africa. That potential, the word potential in education, means absolutely nothing if you don't put a purpose to reach out to it. And we develop fears. And that's the only way to overcome fear. Jump into it. To a Baal Tshuva who walks all his life without a kippah on his head. To put the kippah on his head is like Kriyat Yam Suf. Why? Ooh, put it on, don't worry. Put it on, celebrate it. Put the kippah on, put your tzitzit on, grow your beard. Look like a Jew. I mean, you're a hipster anyway. Don't be afraid. You're afraid of what people would say about the other people who do Chilul Hashem. Good, terrific. You put the kippah on, you put your tzitzit on, you grow your beard on, you do Kiddush Hashem. You balance things out. Because if you're going to do the right things, without the identification, nobody will be able to attribute that to your people. However, you balance things out. You're not being afraid to be called a Jew. I'm a Jew. I'm proud. You have a problem with this? Come over here. I'll show you what I have to say about it. I'll poke your eyes out. I'm not afraid. I'm a Jew. Fear. So what do? Right in it. You're afraid to swim? Go learn how to swim. Not only are you going to learn how to swim, I'm going to learn how to swim. No. You're going to give yourself a target. I'm going to learn how to swim, and within a month from now, I want to be able to swim 5 miles. Give yourself a target. There's a guy who does it all the time, Tim Ferriss. He takes all the things that he's afraid of, and he becomes the best at. I think his thing is like to learn 20% of the most 80% important. I don't know, something like this. Go look at this. He's a very interesting guy. You are all afraid of something. You're all afraid of letting go. You're afraid of letting go. You're afraid of letting go because you want your security. And then you have to be Rabbi because it is expensive to do this. It's expensive to do that. You know, it's expensive to send kid to yeshiva. You know how much meat costs? You know how much kosher meat costs? You're afraid of one thing. You're afraid of believing in a Kadosh Baruch Hu. You all in theory do, but you're afraid. You're afraid to come to yeshiva and to learn. So you work half a day. What's the big deal? You give yourself a target. I need to be able to learn half a day. How do I do that? How do you do it? You're going to sit down. You're going to solve the problem. Yeah, so it means that you have to cut down a little bit of your fantasy lifestyle that is not there to begin with. It's purposeless. You said, that's what I want to do, you know? So I want to become a black belt. So become a black belt. Get up every morning, practice in the morning, practice, become a black belt. But in theory, I'm a good fighter, but I never did the exercise. I never gave a goal. It will never happen. I'm afraid of achieving the goal. That's the fear of people achieving graduation. They're afraid to graduate. I'm afraid to believe in HaKadosh Baruch Hu. That's why I'm holding on to any possession I can, making any excuse in the book not to actually come and sit down and learn. Bottom line is all about emunah. You don't believe. That's why you're afraid. So if you have fear, Rabotai, attack it. Hatkafa. Attack it. Hatkafa, also mishon tokef. Tokef is what? Meaning and validation. When I have a fear, I need to validate my emunah in HaKadosh Baruch Hu by going in and knowing HaKadosh Baruch Hu will help me. Shabbat Shalom.